So thank you everyone for making the time and choosing to hear what we're doing with the legislation in Colorado. Let me just first say a couple of disclaimers. First of all, I'm not an attorney. This is not legal advice. And actually, I'm not even a legislator or a politician. The CEO of a company called Block Lab. And what happened was, you know, you have these events in your life where you decide that it's just too important not to allocate time to it. This is one of those things. This is groundbreaking work, and this is a team effort, and I'll talk a little bit about the team behind all of this. I happen to be lucky enough to be able to speak to you guys today. But there's a lot of work, a lot of effort being done all across the country. And so just a little bit of backdrop, I'll hit you with a punchline right here, which is, this is the Denver Post a couple weeks ago, the 10th. And what this recaps is an incredible 9-week process in which bills were introduced into the Colorado legislature to try and establish blockchain legislation riding on the momentum of Wyoming. And so we'll talk a little bit about Wyoming as well. Because it's the only place in the US at this point we have a landmark legislation that actually frames tokens and makes a distinction between tokens and securities. Okay. So what I was asked to do was give an overview of this. There are only 6 slides, so I'm not gonna kill you with PowerPoint. I wanna leave time for plenty of questions. There's gonna be a lot in these slides, and you'll see that, and there's a lot of room for discussion, and there's an awful lot of room going forward for community engagement. We really need to be active in this. So this is the punchline, which is that we lost the legislative run in this General Assembly. This came down to the wire, meaning the Colorado legislature, which by the way, I was unfamiliar with until I jumped onto this. And so we have a limited term legislation, a legislature or General Assembly that begins from January 1st until May 9th. It ends on May 9th. And there are only a couple of times in the history of Colorado it's not ended on May 9th. So that means everything gets pushed into the last part of May. And we have some incredible sponsors, both Senate representatives who work tirelessly with us to get this legislation to where it was. We won, and if you follow the legislation, and I would recommend you read this article, it's actually very well done. We won, and then 35 minutes later we lost on a parliamentary maneuver in which the bill was reopened after being voted on, and one senator changed her vote, and that flipped the equation. So I think there's a lot of positive in this, and there's also some lessons in this around kind of how this process works. I'm an entrepreneur, I'm not a legislator, as I mentioned, so this was like making sausage. We'll talk more about that as we go through. Okay, so a couple of key pieces of data that are important for our conversation. Now, number one, there's no federal guidelines, and I think we've all heard that if we're in the space. There's no clarity with the Securities and Exchange Commission regarding equities, tokens, or any of these other splits. What that means is that there's a lot of noise and a lot of opinion, and there are a lot of legal fees being burned on opinions. But everyone who is involved in tokenization or who is involved in coin offerings is in a gray space. And the reason why the Wyoming legislation was so critically important for us as a country was it established through the legislative process a framework in which you could evaluate utility tokens. It's short, actually, it's HB 70 if you want to read it. There's a link in the presentation. So when you get a copy of it, you can go back and look at it. The legislation is actually very short and very clean. And the reason it's so important is that it's silent on securities. So we describe utility tokens, we are purposely silent on securities. Because as soon as we talk about securities, we move into the SEC, we move into federal, okay? So there are no Colorado legislation, until this year, until this General Assembly, there were no Colorado state regulations for utility tokens or cryptocurrency, or blockchain for that matter. So today we have one piece of legislation which passed, and what I'll do in the presentation, it's here, and again, you can go back. You can go online and look up in the Colorado General Assembly, you can look up those bill numbers, that's the reference. So at any time you can look at it, see what's going on. The session's closed, but those pieces of legislation are there. And you see HB 18 is 086 is the government, the General Assembly authorized the government to look at through the Office of the CIO of Colorado, to look at government protection of data and cybersecurity. And that's the only blockchain bill that passed in this General Assembly, okay? Now, the other thing that's really relevant here is that for the very first time, and again, I think this is all good, it raised the conversation with the legislature, the whole legislature, and it also put the educational institutions in our state on alert that they have a mandate now, which you'll see right here, to actually include blockchain, cryptocurrency, and tokenization in their framework for education. So for those schools that have, let's say, a hodgepodge collection of classes and courses, the state's actually being very clear that you need to move ahead and recognize this. So again, I think there are some wins in here. So again, positive. The other positive coming from this, you look for the glass to be half full, even though the legislation you sponsored didn't pass. What this does is it actually, I think, will hit one of the foundational concerns, which is why the legislation didn't pass, was fear of the unknown. And so what this is also doing is it's forcing the state agencies to become familiar with blockchain, to be familiar with cryptocurrency, to become more familiar with tokenization. And what it's doing is, you'll see here, it says it's going to force the agencies who are actually opposing us to, and the legislature has actually asked for a report on their progress. So I think we're going to see some positive from that. And we had direct and specific resistance from the Securities and Exchange Commission, from the Division of Insurance, and we also had resistance from the Attorney General's office. Again, you can all do this, by the way, you can go back and see the testimony. So any of the testimony that we provided is all recorded, and I believe this is converted to text by now. But you can see that the opposing positions that we had were all around cryptocurrency scams. They were not about blockchain, they were not about tokens. They were on cryptocurrency scams. And I think that speaks to a level of education that we need to help our legislators and senators understand, and the agencies as well. The Banking Commission was also opposed, and we'll talk about that in a second as well. Okay, so other important activities, because we're not working in a vacuum. In Colorado, as I said, we have one piece of legislation now that talks about blockchain. But across the country, after the Wyoming watershed legislation, other states moved very, very quickly, and I have an update to this as of even yesterday. So Tennessee passed registration legislation regarding the use of smart contracts and blockchain technology for corporate record keeping. So if you think about compliance and audit risk management, putting that information on blockchain is a revolutionary idea. That actually came from legislation out of Wyoming, which has to do with serial LLCs and direct registration onto the blockchain. Arizona has actually been very proactive with legislation in two areas. I think the other thing, of those two, the thing that's most interesting to me is that residents of Arizona can pay their taxes using cryptocurrency. That was the first. Now, what's interesting is yesterday, Florida passed the same legislation. So if you're a Florida resident, you can pay your taxes using cryptocurrency. That's literally hot off the press as of yesterday. So let's go back to the watershed event. On 3/10, Governor Meade, Wyoming, was the culmination of these five elements of blockchain legislation that actually define tokenism. One of the things that we did purposefully here, and again, this is the Colorado, the Wyoming Blockchain Coalition, is an entire group of people. You may see some YouTube videos from Caitlin Long and a few others. This is a very cooperative, energetic, passionate group that I was fortunate enough to meet some of its members when I was in Davos in January, which is how I got pulled into this. We purposely wrote legislation around open blockchain and distributed ledger. The term open blockchain was purposeful. We tried to bring that into Colorado as well, because we recognize that what we understand to be the distributed ledger today is evolving. And we needed to make sure we didn't put ourselves in a corner with the evolution of the market. So a very concrete example is the difference between what we understand to be the blockchain now and some innovative solutions that are post-blockchain. Things like IOTA, EOS, and others, who are not using consensus mechanisms in the same way that Bitcoin does. All right, because we realize there are some scale problems and challenges with that. So to move into the machine economy, you've got to change the paradigm. So we didn't want to have innovators, entrepreneurs, find themselves in a legislative blind spot. So we defined the distributed ledger and open blockchain. We defined a utility token. And then the other thing, which I actually think is probably, I would love to see this being at a federal level. And there are some conversations happening right now. For those of you who are finance people in the audience, you're familiar with the money transmitter laws. For those of you who aren't, let me just take 2 minutes and explain that to you. Before we had a Federal Reserve, all right, so this is really not that long ago, 1913. So what happened was all the states controlled their own money flow. And part of our Constitution required had a separation of powers around the cooperative union of the states against the federal government. There's a lot of resistance to a Federal Reserve. But what the Federal Reserve did was it acted as a transfer agent and a stability mechanism for a currency. But before that, there was a lot of volatility between states. The states, including Colorado, had their own currencies. And that was fine if you were trading in Colorado, but what happens when you're trading with Wyoming or Kansas or any neighboring states, if they have a different currency? Or how did you index that? And so the Federal Reserve evolved out of that. But in order for the states to maintain their control, again, because of state sovereignty over federal, state sovereignty, what they did was they have money transmitter licenses, which are the on-ramps and the off-ramps to the Federal Reserve System. So the State Banking Commission controls those on-ramps and off-ramps. In our world, which is virtual and digital currency, that means in order to transmit efficiently across the country, and the Federal Reserve controls the international gate internationally, you have to have a money transmitter license. Now, the money transmitter license is actually very bank-centric. Bank, investment house, institutional loan servicing companies. So they require P&L balance sheet, certain measures. They require certain surety bonds and things like that, because that system self-insures. We realized that we could not be a bank. We didn't want to be a bank. So what we asked for was an exemption from that. Okay, so you'll hear in legislation coming up, and you'll hear it again next year, we're looking for a money transmitter exemption. We don't want to become a money transmitter, because then we'd be a bank. That's a whole other set of regulations. Now what that means is, ideally, we would have access to that system with the appropriate disclaimers and waivers of liability that we as individual peer-to-peer transaction participants do not have the same guarantees if we were an institutional provider moving money across the ACH system. That's really what the goal is. So that's really important, because if you want to do if you want to have commerce across the states, then that's the most efficient way to do it. Okay? Then the other thing has to do with the registration of LLCs on the blockchain, and then there are 17 states that have serial LLCs, which means you can have a parent-child relationship between LLCs. Sure.
So if I had a company in Wyoming where I don't need a money transmitter license, does that mean I can only like do that within Wyoming? And if I wanted to transact with someone in Colorado, I would also, in Colorado, require that license, I would have to get it from Colorado?
Yeah, so what's happening is, and this is one of the things that will be tested in court. So there are two, the Wyoming legislation knowingly put a stake in the ground, realizing two things had to be litigated. But if we didn't have a case to litigate, then the conversation would never happen, right? One of them has to do with interstate commerce, and the other one has to do with if it's a peer-to-peer transaction right now, you would actually go fiat to crypto, crypto to fiat. And there are utilities right now that allow you to do that. But on a business, from a business perspective, if you're trying to make this, if you're trying to move this out of peer-to-peer, it's actually making it more of a, more useful for business-to-business transactions. This has to be challenged. So that's part of the money transmitter exemption. And there are a number of cases pending, I've learned, across the country around this specific thing. So our businesses could transact using the ACH system. Because today, if we had an account at Elevation, or we had an account at Bank of America, we could transmit business to business. Right now, if you tried to do that on the drop-down in your online banking, it would never show up. Because there's not, right, there's a whole set of legislative and a whole set of requirements behind that before your ID can show up as being a send to or send from. This is actually some of the same problem that the marijuana industry has with movement of cash. So does that make sense, those four elements? Okay. So then the other thing was we defined an open blockchain and distributed ledger. And the idea was that the token was property, not currency. That's a huge distinction. Because property is managed by the state, not by the federal government. Currency is managed by the federal government. So states have their own jurisdiction on property. The other thing that was done in Wyoming was, just so there wasn't any disproportionate, there wasn't any problem with that, the state also granted, in this case, that property be exempt from property taxes. All right, so that meant you can innovate and you can treat the token as property, but you don't have to worry about property taxes. Okay, so let's come back to Colorado, because those two pieces of history are important, because in the timing, March 10th, and remember I mentioned the General Assembly was already underway, January through May. So what we did is we introduced two bills mid-session. So we knew that was a risk, but we didn't really lose the window of opportunity if we could take it. So there are two bills, HB 1220 and 277. So 1220 is actually a replication of the Wyoming statutes. And again, the states often use statutes from other states. Why reinvent the wheel? So the utility token and blockchain legislation came in under 1220, and then 277 was the money transmitter exemption. You can look up both of those bills online, and you'll also notice they map back to 1426. And the reason for that is when we had the Senate hearing, so we went through the House, went through the Senate hearing, the open blockchain utility token was lost in committee, in terms of a vote. And again, that became, that was due to direct pressure from the Securities Exchange Commission and the Banking Commission. And by the way, these are very nice people. I don't want you to think that they're not. What's happening is there's a mismatch between an understanding of mission and focus in education. So we spent hours with the Banking Commission and with the Securities Exchange Commission. And I actually am empathetic. The Securities Exchange Commission is a little bit stuck between a rock and a hard place because the federal government hasn't been clear, and they're the representative of the federal government and the state. So they took the position that everything was a security. And so we worked diligently with law teams as well as the state on finding language that would allow us to be able to get through the legislature and the Senate. We lost that, and it was brought back the next day and attached to the money transmitter exemption as an amendment. So what you see is that they now locked together, and we brought those through the Senate and legislature. Senator Neville and Tate, phenomenal representatives. They got it. They understand what we're trying to do. They wanted to stimulate innovation and have on and Melton as well in the House. So we have a good team. I don't know who would sponsor for the next session, but I think that we will, as I said, raise the awareness. And we do have other business leaders in the community. Jeff was part of this as well. I'm gonna call you out, so I'm sorry. You don't have to stay on the phone. But Jeff Perrin was able to testify. We have some other people who are going to be coming today who were able to testify as well. And again, we're the business community, and we're trying to explain to the legislators and the senators why this is important. There is a Telegram channel that I have listed here. It's a broadcast-only channel. We'll continue to use that because coming out of this process, even though we lost the technically lost the bills, the governor signed an executive order shortly after this whole process to establish a task force for the state to actually do exactly what I said, which was increase the inclusion, get the parties together so we can actually work on this and drive a successful set of legislation in the next General Assembly. There's some risk to that because other states are already moving, and we have people who are looking to start companies or move companies. We'd like to keep them here if we can. But again, I think people have to look at their own timing for that. Are there any questions on this? No, okay. Okay, so this was the one of the wrap-up slides. So we won originally 18 to 17, and then 20 minutes later we lost 17 to 18. So education, fear-based education efforts were what was going on in the legislature, sure.
What's the split on that? Is it Democrats, Republicans, city, non-city?
I'm sorry?
Who voted for it as far as political meaning?
You know what? I thought I was gonna get asked that question. So what you can do is you can look at the bill, and you can actually see who voted for and against. I really don't wanna call out any specific senators or parties, but there were party line splits, and there were a couple of senators that actually we spent a lot of time with and representatives to see if we could get them to understand where we're coming from. And again, what I can tell you from the face-to-face conversations I've had, a lot of it was, this is so much so fast, and you're coming in mid-session. Like we've had no on-ramp time. This makes me feel uncomfortable.
It wasn't a party line split.
No, it wasn't a clear party line split. I was actually thinking that might be the case, and I was delighted to see that wasn't the case. So I think there's willingness on the part of the legislature and the Senate, independent of party, but I think that what we encountered was we had to bring people up to speed on four major concepts where they were already kind of in the legislative session. Like, what's the blockchain, right? Like, what's that? And then how is that different than Bitcoin? And what's Bitcoin? And what's cryptocurrency? And what's a token? So I can appreciate it, but again, for our collective self-interest, I wanted them to say yes, right? So this is, these are some of the questions, you know, what is cryptocurrency? And again, this is not happening in an echo chamber, right? Because you've got other constituents who are saying no to the money transmitter exemption, right? Because the banks want to control this. And so one of the, this represents a very real and direct threat to centralized banking services. And so you'd expect that. So again, not being a politician, being an entrepreneur, I was immersed immediately into politics and kind of vested interests. So, and again, these are very nice people who are trying to do the best they can, and they have a specific point of view. And I think that's why the task force is going to be so important, because now without the pressure of time, although the General Assembly people are already preparing for that now, we'll have time, more time, but we need people in the community to get involved in these efforts so that legislators who are running for re-election, senators who are running for re-election, understand this is an important plank around innovation. I also hope the SEC comes out with a clear set of guidelines regarding security.
Sure.
Yeah, that was my question. So if the SEC does come out with guidelines, which I believe they will, and I think they have to.
Well, you know, it's interesting.
How does that, I'm not going to hold my breath, but if that happens, how does that affect these local bills? And does it?
Well, see, I think that, so what's happening is, I think that the SEC, the states, not only this state or Wyoming, states are putting stakes in the ground around utility tokens and consumptive tokens, and they're calling them property. Now, right now, the SEC has a blanket statement that they believe every ICO is a security. I think they're moderating that position. It's interesting, again, their mission and focus is guarding the public trust, right? So I really appreciate where they're coming from, but if you're trying to innovate in the area of tokens, and it's clearly property and it's a service, it's for consumptive use, then it's not a security. So, when we were in the legislative session, even after, the securities commissioners, Jerry Brom here in the state, he was saying to us that the SEC is due to come out with clarity in the next few months. And I understand his position. He's a litigator by training, and you know, he sees all of the worst of the worst, right? So I appreciate his point of view. And I think there's a matter of balancing it. So we don't have clarity. I just came back from Boulder Blockchain Week in New York. And it was that was a huge topic of conversation, you know, right in the shadow of Wall Street. Although most of that's being done in DC. Okay, so we need to prepare to win in 2019. As I mentioned, the governor signed the executive order for the task force. That's being run out of the Office of Economic Development, and that's an active conversation. I pushed a notice out onto the Telegram channel for anyone who is interested in participating. The way I envision this happening, it's going to be a small group, and it's going to be distributed. We need to get a lot of people involved community-wide, and I don't think it's going to be centralized. Again, I think it's consistent with the model of decentralization. So we want to be able to decentralize that small group and get the message out in the business community and help people understand how it works. I do think there will be educational meetings, and I know that we've had the opportunity in a couple of meetups to speak to meetup groups. That's really important, Slack channels and other means of getting the word out. I think the other thing I would like you to know is legislators and senators do respond to email. So, and I know on the Colorado blockchain legislation channel, we have specific committee members, senators and representatives that we identified, people sent email, and they did comment about that during the testimony, so they do read their email. Yeah, sure.
Since this blockchain and everything is sort of tech-focused, is there an ideal background for the people who are getting involved? I mean, some of the finance background and accounting background, if they were to actually get into the nitty gritty how everything works, I would not be able to hold my own as a developer.
So I think the background, so I don't think there's an ideal background. I think what happens is we're trying to move this into the mainstream. It's not just a tech play. And I think that everyone has a point of view, and I actually think it would be nice to broaden it even more from a tech background. And because we're trying, like I said, we're trying to mainstream this, right? So we're trying to do business-to-business transactions. We're trying to innovate. When you take a look at some of the innovation for tokenization, it may be technical on the platform level, but the use case is all business. It's real estate, it's, you know, other properties, it's services. So I don't think that there's an ideal like skill set. I think that the common behavioral characteristic is a sense of humor and persistence. I'm serious. It's just because you look at these things and you say, I don't understand how that can be interpreted that way. Like, really?
Yeah.
So I mean, I think that there's a, you have to be persistent and you have to be able to listen to different points of view and really get underneath it. And I think one of the things that we lose in some of the electronic communication is that perspective. It's the face-to-face, the meetup conversations, it's the legislator, the hallway conversations with senators, which I had never done before, were amazing. Like, oh, that's what you mean. Or I didn't understand that's where you're coming from. We lose that in text messaging and email. So I really think it's gonna be a grassroots, have a conversation, talk to your senator, talk to your representative. It sounds old school, but it seems to be what works. Sure.
So you've been obviously focusing mainly on Colorado, looking at the spread, what's happened in Wyoming.
Yeah. What I want to know, but let me be clear. Wyoming, for me, was an opportunity to learn what I needed to do to bring it to Colorado.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so this is home. I didn't know what I didn't know, and so the best thing for me to do was say, I had some, my company, I said, look, I need to take a little time to work on this, because this is too big not to understand completely, and how am I gonna do that? I'm gonna step into it. So I basically took myself off the schedule, if you will, and spent some time in Wyoming with a great group of people. So I didn't mean to prevent you from asking a question, but it's important that you understand
it. Right. So like going in the future, do you see plans for like a larger campaign, maybe on like federal level or like national level?
They're already happening. So what's happening is there are state campaigns that I'm aware of. I'm not part of any of that. Again, my focus is Colorado, and I have the benefit of being plugged into some of the folks who are dealing with the national as well as international. There were some conversations even yesterday, we were talking about this before, the conference of Crypto House. There were people from the UK who were talking about the sandbox that they've developed for crypto. And it's actually being used by the parliament to understand the behavior and characteristics of crypto. So basically you get a 1-year sandbox permit, if you will. And then the characteristics and behavior of you can go to market, but it's inside that sandbox. It's kind of a soft launch. And so that actually allows the EU to understand more and more about crypto. So there are places across the globe that are actually much more advanced and moving very quickly, which is actually the difference between historical space and this space, right? Because it's all global. And so that's what's happening. So yes, I'm aware of it. That's not my focus, actually. I'm aware of it.
Sure. I'd like to exchange. I have a couple organizations I was involved with,
yeah.
Like youth organizations, that you might be interested in.
Yeah, there are a couple of groups. One of them is Data, data.org, that actually came out of Wyoming as well. And those are some of the folks that I met in the World Economic Forum in Davos, and that's where this conversation kind of crystallized. And they're actually international. So there are people who are working of that group who are in Asia, who are in Europe, South America, and actually Australia. Bermuda just announced a full set of legislation to make it crypto friendly. So what they're doing is, in these states, in city, states, and countries are looking at this as an innovation opportunity for economic expansion, which is exactly what we're trying to do in Colorado, which is exactly what Wyoming is trying to do, and the same thing in Arizona. So we just think front range.
Sure.
Did the whole token issuance in Venezuela do more harm than good?
Time allows. I'm happy to go into that. What we were talking about was a general overview, but I've got a couple slides at the end. If we have time, we can go deep into the token. There was another question at the back.
Yeah, right here. For the task force, is that Stephanie Copeland picking that? Or?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, she's actually the one who received the request from the governor. And there's a small group of us who are working with her on that, and we're trying to get the group. Right now, I've asked people on the channel to tell me if they're interested. I don't know what that means yet. And then what we're doing is we're working on getting a balance. We want a lot of different points of view, but we want a small group. And I think part of that is the conversation of how we do that.
How big is it going to be? How many people are going
to
be?
You know what? That's a great question. I mean, we go from 10 to 8 to 15. I don't know.
I can help a little bit by saying that Stephanie and others who are trying to set this up, they're not really sure what the mission of that task force is. There's a process of how that occurred. And you saw the word education and Paul's stuff. I think education is going to be a big part of it. So we'll see.
So in the presentation, I have a set of references for you. So when you get the PDF file, you're welcome to go back over that. But the other thing I thought you would really appreciate, and I don't know if I can do it live, this was launched yesterday. Anyone have seen it?
Yeah.
That's great. All right. So I thought this was, you know, here we are. So much for that. So for those of you who haven't seen it yet, please look at this. The SEC launched a site on the SEC. And what they did was, because this is moving so fast and there's so much misinformation, what they did was they launched a fake token sale called the Howie token. So those of you who are involved in this know the Howie test. So what they did was they launched the Howie token. Now, if you try to buy on the Howie token, which I saw some numbers this morning that said they had like 11,000 people try to buy, what it does is it brings you to an educational, deep educational section, like why you shouldn't buy. But I thought it was very clever.
SEC has a sense of humor.
Sorry?
SEC has a sense of humor.
Well, you know, the SEC for all of the heat they're taking in this, have been actually, they're very digitally aware. And they're very, again, their mission is around public trust, right? And securities fraud, right? Yeah. And so they see some of the most elaborate schemes you can imagine that people create to get your money. So they have a purposely jaded view of the, because it's all the negative. The positives they don't hear about, they hear about the negatives. So what I thought was really clever was, if you look at this site, you'll find all of the elements of all of the scams in the site. So it looks like here, buy this, it's rate limited, it's quantity limited, guaranteed returns. It's all the wrong language that you should look at. And if you really get bought into it, you could try to buy. And it brings you to, again, a much more structured content section around why you shouldn't buy, and you should listen to these things. So I thought it was very clever. And you know, Blockchain Week in New York is ending Friday, and consensus, and then Ethereum consensus was earlier in the week. So the number of people who are just involved in the space globally were there. And I thought the timing of this was actually very clever. Because there were a lot of conversations with legislators. There were some presentations by members of Congress and the Senate.
Sure.
I think what you said is really important. We have the SEC because of the Great Depression, because 1929. It's like they put all this stuff in place, and it's frustrating that they're slow. It's frustrating that they're the federal top of the food chain.
Correct.
But they are in place to prevent many people from losing their entire network.
Yes, that's right.
So
that's right.
So like it's frustrating from this side of the table, but. Yeah. This is what they have to do is to get to the point where the technology is mature, they can really understand what they're regulating in order to regulate it.
Well, I also think there's another dimension here, which I look for the glass half full in this. What this is doing is, you know how people look at crowdsourcing as a funding mechanism, right? I actually see the positive in this, which is it's engaging people, including me, who have been on the sidelines for a very long time going, if somebody else is taking care of that.
Right.
Right. Well, now, you know what, this is too big and it touches too many things and I need to get engaged.
Right.
And I would encourage anyone else here in the room to do the same thing. That doesn't mean, you can define that however you need to, but I think that getting engaged, having a point of view, having a position, I know I sound like a community activist, but that's really what it is. It is actually driving because the platform's digital, it's driving people to approach however, whatever channel they want to use. And I think the question then becomes where, right? And I think that coming out of the task force, I think one of the things we have to do is define a where. So you can direct your questions, you can direct your commentary, we can surface. I would like to see this very, as definitely as well, want this to be very transparent. We want the community engagement. So if we end up with greater community engagement on this, it's a win-win. And I think it will help us accelerate where we're going. Sure.
So how are the utility tokens defined as different from a security on the bill? Was it just they said that it can't be returned?
You have 2 minutes. Okay. Great segue question. All right. So this slide is actually taken right out of the legislation in Wyoming. This is exactly what we brought into Colorado. All right, and so the simplicity of this is the beauty in this, okay? So the token is not being marketed as an investment. That's critical. If it's an investment, then it belongs to the Securities Exchange Commission. You need to go through the regulatory filings, and you need to invest, and you need to register as a security. Its token is designed for exchange of goods or services. Now, there's a tremendous amount of innovation in those two words, goods and services. Whether it's bandwidth, file storage, property, or any number of other things that can be tokenized. The market will prove out whether that works or not. But again, what this provides is a mechanism to do it, not a validation of your business plan. The market will validate your business plan. Okay? And then, so the other thing is, you're not the developer. Sure.
Yeah, so just to so when a token sale, a lot of times it's a free product. So, how does this protect against people buying the token and with the understanding, like, there's the pre sale, right? So, they use a discount, or then there's the actual ICO. Like, this doesn't do anything to stop someone from selling a token and saying, well, it's going to be worth more at a later date.
So it's interesting. So what's happening is one of the things the SEC has been very focused on has been how the token offering is made, what the marketing of the token is, and what the expectations of a potential buyer are by the seller.
Okay.
Right. So if you say that the token has, so it, I mean, it's really when you roll back a little bit out of tokenism, a Ponzi scheme is actually a very good term for the use of some of the quantity limited discounted tokens that have been in the market, right?
Right.
Because built into that, okay, I didn't say the word guaranteed return, but I'm giving it to you at a discount.
Right. So your pre-sale, if you get it now, then you're going to be able to sell it at a higher date.
Exactly.
And then the other thing of tokens exchangeable for goods or services. So the problem I see with most ICOs is right now the goods or services are coming at a later date, and then at the later date, the token, the messages, the token will be worth more. So
right.
If you buy it now, you're going to get discount for goods and services at a later date.
Correct.
That's
which is no different than seed money to build a product or service.
Well, seed, right, but seed money, you own equity. So the seed money is an investment.
Good point.
That marks off the first one.
I mean, based on that definition, you couldn't have a token that isn't currently exchangeable, right? It says is exchangeable, not will be exchangeable.
Well, so it's interesting that what's happened is part of the innovation, there was a lot of conversation this past week about this, on the Ethereum platform, on the smart contracts, the ERC-20s.
Yeah.
What's happening now is people are evolving the smart contracts to put terms and boundaries on the token. So you're actually eliminating the opportunity for arbitrage.
No, I mean, I get that. I'm saying, you know, verbiage is incredibly important in legislation, right? And so what they're going to look at is what verbiage did they pick? And they chose is exchangeable, which means current state is exchangeable, not will be in the future. So if I launch a token that's not currently exchangeable, I don't qualify under little Roman numeral two, right? So then at that point, I'm potentially a security.
That's correct.
This was actually different in our legislation.
Right.
Slightly altered to fix that exact opposite.
Yeah, but you have to hit all those to be core element of the utility.
Are there any other questions?
We have to wrap up.
You guys have been great. Yeah.